Hi everyone, I'm Cécile Sardac and I'm an engineer working for Biblisma Plus and the Campus Condorcet in France. My colleague Mathilde Doga and I are here to share a bit about a project of dissemination of IIIF that is currently in progress in the French Archives Network. So, as IIIF is currently marginally used in the French Archives Network, a project stemmed last year from the dialogue between Biblisma and France Archives. So, Biblisma Plus is a multi-site digital infrastructure dedicated to the history of the transmission of ancient texts. So, Biblisma Plus is involved in the community since about 2013, resulting in multiple projects and sites which are compatible with IIIF. One of the main websites of Biblisma is the Biblisma portal, which aggregates data and metadata and images when possible with IIIF. And all of this data comes from a variety of institutions, from France or internationally. So the Cluster 1 of Biblisma in particular works toward promoting the acquisition of interoperable source corpora. And by that, we mainly mean IIIF resources. So France Archives is a partner of this cluster. So the implementation of IIIF is of course interesting for the archival institutions themselves, for their own benefits and use cases, but a goal is also to share these images on multiple portals, France Archives and ultimately the Biblisma portal. So the project started last year and was given dedicated funds, and as a result, two engineers were hired, us. So the target of this project is all of the archives network in France. So this network, in addition to the national archives, consists mainly of local institutions, and these institutions coincide with territorial levels in France. So we have departmental archives, which are our main targets, and also regional and communal archives. So these institutions are quite numerous and diverse, each of them having their own websites, and different providers are behind these websites. So we have to deal with what is already existing and with the constraints of each institution. So we developed a specific strategy targeting software providers and archival institutions. So our priority and first step was to work with software vendors and to meet with them, because we wanted to inform them of our approach, and it was also important because we needed their input to determine a strategy aimed at the archives. It was also a good opportunity to guide them towards best practices early in their implementation journey. And so that's why we wrote some recommendations that we shared with them. So among approximately 10 software providers, two had already implemented the image and presentation APIs, but these implementations were not quite fully functional yet, and there was not widely spread among their customers. And one more provider had already implemented the image API only. So on the other end of the spectrum, some software providers haven't heard of IIIF at all before meeting us. So again, the situation were quite diverse. But the results of this meeting were quite positive, because most providers stated that they were interested in IIIF, but they also stated that they are in need of support and of more requests from customers. In the meantime, we also worked with archives institutions. So IIIF was very rarely known by archivists, and even those who had already heard of IIIF were not really aware of IIIF use cases and benefits, or even core principles. So we had the opportunity to give a few presentations about IIIF and our project targeting archives. Our approach was meant to be as pedagogical as possible. So because we wanted to know about the mindset of archivists, we conducted a survey at the beginning of this year, and almost all of the respondents stated that they are interested in using IIIF in their institution, but that they are in need of more information beforehand. So to meet this demand, we launched training courses, and the goal of these training courses was to acquaint this non-technical audience with IIIF. And because of that, we choose to focus on use cases and benefits of IIIF, on a few elementary technical points, and also on keys on how to start using IIIF when you are interested in it. We chose a half-a-day webinar format because we wanted quite a broad participation, but each session was limited to 15 to 20 participants because we wanted to allow engagement and discussions among trainees. The results are quite positive, and we will have to schedule more sessions in the fall to meet demand. By the end of June, we expect that about 40% of department archives will have at least one member that had taken part in a training course, which is not bad. When working with archivists, we also had to circumvent some fears or common misconceptions. Most of these fears were about the broad reuse of IIIF resources and statistics security or increased bandwidth requirements. So again, we are to be pedagogical when working with archivists, and these are also topics that we have to discuss with software vendors. We're also currently working on recommendations about the minimal metadata that should be included in manifests in our setting in French archives, because we want to promote more homogeneous practices among our community. And so the training courses were a good opportunity to consult archivists about this topic, and these are the results of this consultation. And a work group will be set up very soon to discuss this topic. Mathilde, you can say a few words about France Archives.
Thank you. I will now present you the IIIF project on France Archive. So France Archive is a national aggregator for archival data in France. It is online since March 2017. It has 156 partners and 135 content providers, that is to say institutions that have their data online. These are mostly public archival institutions from the French Archive Institution Network, but our partners are also public institutions or private institutions. The Travel Life integration project is co-financed by Biblecinema Plus and Service Interministériel des Archives de France as part of the actions of Cluster 1. It started in June 2022 with the recruitment of an engineer dedicated to the project, me. There are two aims in this project. The first one is to use France Archive as a showcase of what can be done with IIIF and to encourage archivists to use this technology. The second one is to use France Archive as a bridge for other projects and platforms such as Biblissima or Archives Portal Europe and Europeana. I will now present you very quickly what exists on France Archive now. So the images are displayed within the corresponding records on France Archive pages. We linked the manifest to these pages. We choose Mirador 3 because it is most used by French institutions, so we thought it would be easier for our user to use it. And because its features are very interesting for an aggregator like us, especially the fact that it is a multi-window image viewing platform. The first images are online since December 2022. We only have four departmental archives for now, but it's only the beginning of the project, so we expect to have more in the months to come. Of course, we work very closely with our partner. Each institution is supported in the process and receives an authorization request before the images are displayed on France Archive. Here is a quick demo of what Mirador 3 looks like on France Archive. About the next steps, we plan to add another viewer, probably universal viewer. We also want to create collections such as thematic collections, collection of cadastral plant and register. And we also want to use valorization tools such as Exhibit to better feature digitized archives through virtual exhibition, quiz, etc. The main goal is to multiply and diversify the uses of IIIF on France Archive to enhance the digital collections on the portal, but also to show archives the possibilities offered by IIIF. We communicated a lot about the project and we met archivists, so we can say that the project has led archives to want to know more about IIIF and helps to deconstruct fears and assumptions they had. But just because archivists are interested in IIIF and are aware of the advantages of their own website doesn't mean they are comfortable with the idea of their images being reused so easily, so we still have a lot of work to do.
So to conclude, as our project is still at an early stage, it's too early to really measure the impact of our efforts in terms of future new implementation and usage in archival institutions. However, the first results are quite encouraging, as IIIF is now a topic of interest among the French archives community. Thanks to all.
Thank you both. It is super exciting to see these national level implementation projects, and we're going to get to see another one tomorrow. So it's a running theme. So do you have any questions? We probably have 2-3 minutes. Going once. Ronald?
Thank you very much. Looks really exciting. And there is some work being done on 3D, I believe, on a national level as well. Is that interconnected with your work?
Actually, in archives, we have very few 3D objects. And so we feel that it's not a priority at the moment, but maybe in the future.
We may want to connect. There is another group that comes to the Tribrar 3D, so good to know. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much for your presentation, and it's absolutely great to see that this will become more and more available, and that you're doing this at the national level. I was wondering, there are, of course, more libraries, French libraries, that already are IIIF. I guess they are a little bit ahead. So I was wondering, does that help the archives, and what is the relationship to this project about archives and libraries that are maybe already using it?
Yeah, it's true that most institutions that use IIIF in France are libraries, along with research infrastructure. And so it can be used as an example, of course, to push the interest towards IIIF. The National Library of France, the BNF, uses IIIF since a few years now. And yes, it can be a great example of what can be done with IIIF, and also to have feedback on all how these implementations were done and so on.
Thank you. So in the interest of time, since we have some people who won't be visiting, who won't be coming with us this evening, and we don't want to take up too much of the time of people who are looking to go back and crash at their hotel, but we will have a little gap between the time that we wrap up here and we get on the buses. So if you want to ask any more questions of any of our presenters, we'll have some time for that as well. You want to queue up? Okay. So there is a slight change in the schedule. The next presenters on the schedule were not able to make it. So next up, we are going to welcome Marcin Hilinski.
Okay, good afternoon. My name is Marcin Hilinski. I came to you from Poznań, from Poznań Supercomputing and Networking Center. Here's the agenda of my presentation. I will tell you something about the company I represent, and then I will describe the services that actually use this technology, and then I will focus on some information about current work and future plans. So PSNC was actually founded in 1993, so this year we celebrate our 30th anniversary. We are affiliated to the Institute of Bioorganic Chemistry of the Polish Academy of Sciences. We are actually a non-profit organization, so we are research and development center and also operator of Polish e-infrastructure. we are operator of Polish optical internet that is called Pioneer, which integrates 21 academic metropolitan networks and five high-power computing centers. We have almost 500 employees, 16 laboratories, 16 departments, over 16 of fields of activity. Currently, we're working on 65 projects, and we've been participating in over 100 of projects related to Horizon 2020 and our Digital Europe programs. Our headquarters is called Polish Optical Internet Research Center. We have laboratories there and our primary data center. At another location in Poznań, there is a backup data center, and we have also a place where we have co-working space. And something from the recent years, we have a new research center where we work on unmanned aerial vehicles. It's in Konkolevo Airport. And like many domains are in scope of our interest. So we work on networks, high performance computing, big data, cybersecurity, medicine, agriculture, energy industry, smart different things, weather, air, new media, culture, and education. And we have over 20 years experience in creating software solutions for cultural heritage and digital humanities communities. Our flagship software is called DINGO, which is an acronym from Digitize and Go. It consists of a couple of different applications. Delibra and Dimuseon are kind of similar, but are intended for different types of institutions. Delibra is rather for libraries, repositories, and archives, and Dimuseon is for museums. We have also DLAB system, which is a software that is used for managing the professional digitization pipeline, and is often used with the next system, which is called DRCO, and this is something that is used for long-time data preservation. And there's also a LocLoud system, which is something aimed for small institutions that would like to build their digital library in a fast way, let's say, but they don't have, for example, funds for bigger infrastructure. And the last system, Sinus, is the system that allows managing the university's digital resources and gathers information about activities and achievements of the employees for each university. In terms of Delibra and Demuseon, I can say that there are over 140 GLAMs using the software, and over a dozen of institutions have chosen to use the professional digitization pipelines using the DLAB and DRCO systems. Now, overview with the services using IIIF, we have three of them. Delibra, the number one is called VTL, so it's Virtual Transcription Laboratory, and the last one is Data Exchange Infrastructure Application, together with the Transcribaton platform, actually, that is used for presentation. Starting with Delibra, as I said, this is software for building digital collections, and you can build a digital library with objects consisting of metadata and content in variety of formats. Internally, the Libra is written in Java, so it uses Cantaloupe IIIF server, which is also Java-based. And for presentation, we chose Universal Viewer because it has ability to work with legacy image galleries, which are often used in the Libra as well. In terms of IIIF API, the Libra supports image API and presentation API in versions 2.0. Manifest files are created on demand using the information from the object. I mean, the files that are part of the object are used to build the manifest file. And this is something new. We started supporting content search API in version 1.0, and this is actually based on HOCR or Alto, which has to be provided by the users. But what is interesting here that for highlighting the search results, we use a Solr plugin that is called Solr OCR Highlighting, which works directly on the OCR files, and it does not require to have all the text inside the index. And the second solution that uses IIIF technology is Virtual Transcription Laboratory. It's the service that is used for creating transcriptions, translations, transliterations, annotations, and so on. Internally, it uses IIIF server whenever there is need to perform some conversion from the initial file format to pyramidal TIFF, because this is the format that we chose for IIIF. So we support conversion from different kind of image formats like JPEG, PNG, TIFF, and also Deja Vu. Maybe some of you know this format. And also from PDF. Users can import their images also from other services using the METS file or the IIIF manifest. The software also includes the built-in OCR functionality, which is based on Tesseract engine, and all the text that users create are placed in a separate text layers, which can be exported into a variety of formats like HOCR, text, or TEI. And there's also integration with our other system, the Libra, where all the text enhancements created here are introduced in the Libra as alternative representations of the same record. Virtual Transcription Laboratory supports Image API and Presentation API in the latest versions. Manifests are created again on demand, and they can be created either for the whole project, let's say, so they contain all the information on the text layers that were created by the user, or we also provide possibility to create the manifest just for one text layer. And VTL also supports the content search API in version 1.0. This is always based on the text layers in the project, so it's either possible to search the whole text that was introduced for a record, for a project, or You can also search the specific text layer. All the annotations that are there are always related to the whole line, to the verse, because that's the organization of the text data that is like in backend in database. And what is interesting here also is that we did not implement searching mechanism using Solr, which is probably the most commonly used solution, but we did it using direct search in the database because that was enough for this project. And the last service I would like to present is called Data Exchange Infrastructure, shortly DEI. It was developed within two projects called EnEthiopiana and EnEthiopiana Plus. In both these projects, we cooperated with many partners from different countries in Europe, also with EnEthiopiana. And this project is related to crowdsourcing campaigns that are created, let's say, to improve digital objects quality. And this application, this DEI application, is actually kind of a proxy which exchange data between EnEthiopiana API and Transcribaton platform API. This Transcribaton platform is, as I said before, something that is actually used for those crowdsourcing campaigns. And here we focus mainly on like images, but in the latest project, in this EnEthiopiana Plus project, there was focus on mainly on handwritten documents, dating on the 19th century, let's say. And for each such document, the user can create manual transcriptions, and also, which is something new, automatic transcriptions using HDR technology. This is something that was developed by ReadCop, which is the company that created Transcribus service. And Transcribaton platform supports images where are located at their original location, but also we have our internal IIIF server, which is based on IAP image server. And this Transcribaton platform has its own customized OpenC Dragon viewer. This is the how it looks like on Transcribaton platform. So there is this viewer and the transcription that is done by some user. Here is actually the HDR transcription that was done automatically, and the possibility of navigating between pages of the book, let's say. And before the work in Transcribaton platform is actually possible, we do, let's say, a bit of magic in our backend, so in our DEI. So again, we chose Pyramidal TIFF for our main IIIF compliant file format. So we allow conversion from different types of images and also from PDF. We support image API and presentation API in version 2.0, and manifest file are created only for the resources that were actually converted on our site. So the flow, the workflow is that first, let's say, the user that is kind of a curator has to choose some materials from Europeana using our user interface in DEI, and then he decides to send this materials to Transkibaton platform, and that's the moment when we make the conversion and also create the manifest file, and we have also validation of manifests, and that is done for all the manifests, not only the ones that are created for the converted resources, but also for the manifests that are delivered externally. And something about our current work and the future plans. So besides those three services I have just described, we are currently involved in a big project called Daria Lab. And this is related to building national research infrastructure for art and humanities sciences. There will be five distributed research laboratories that will allow manipulation of digital resources and research data in many ways. And one of the laboratory, we are planning to use a huge cluster of IIP image servers consisting of at least 10 servers with access to over 1 petabyte of shared storage. This will be deployed on Kubernetes, which is a platform for managing and automating and scaling containerized applications. So each IIP image server will be a Docker image that is deployed on this platform. And we are planning to use pyramidal TIFFs, since we have such big storage, so it's not a problem to have big image files. So pyramidal TIFFs again, with possibility of converting them from different kind of images and PDFs, image API and presentation API also in the latest versions. If we have time, we decided to at least investigate possibility of using 3D and audio video support. And for the users, there will be at least REST API for managing their data and acquiring the URLs to the manifest file, for example, that can be later used by them in any IIIF compliant viewer. And that's it. So if you have any questions, I'm here.
Sorry, I think in the interest of time, we're going to do questions offline, but we do have about 40 minutes. We have a few groups who are having some meetings until it's time to get on to the bus. But we'll have some free time for people to ask any of the presenters from today questions. Okay, so thank you, Marcin.